Good morning, Life City Church. I'm so excited to be with you virtually this morning. And yeah, welcome to church. If you're new, we would love to extend you a massive welcome, whether you're watching on YouTube or here with us in our portal. And yeah, there is an option for you at the end of the service, if you want to connect with us in our online lounge, just meet a few of the people here and just have a bit of a chat. All good, really. I hope you guys have all a great week. I'm really looking forward to this Sunday. And without further ado, let's go into a time of worship.
Hey, welcome Life City Church to another awesome Sunday. Whatever comes, whatever goes, there is one thing that I know.
You are never ending.
to the one who holds the stars. We lift you higher, we lift you higher, to the one who holds our hearts. There is no other, there is no other like you. Oh, Jesus Christ, we magnify your life. For your majesty, we crown you King of Kings. been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so
Hi, morning, Life City. It's great to be with you again. And it's my turn to give you your word inspiration for this morning. And it's something that I've been thinking about for a while. I'm going to start with reading the verse straight away. So Matthew 25, verse 21. The master was full of praise. Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount. So now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. And it comes inside with, you know, those words, well done, thou good and faithful servant, something that I'm sure this morning we'll all want to hear when it comes to that day when we meet Jesus face to face, when we leave this earth. And perhaps it's the age I'm at, and perhaps it's partly because of COVID, and we've had time to think and just reflect. And I'm sure, you know, the conversations I've been having with friends has been that they have been thinking about what their life is about. They found hobbies they didn't know they had, and really just trialing different things. And I've certainly found myself reflecting on my life and what I've done so far, and just thinking about the talents, the abilities, and the skills that I have. And I want to hear, like you, I'm sure, those words, that well done, that good and faithful servant. So I started thinking, well, what does that mean? What does it mean to hear those words? And if we look at that verse and that whole passage in Matthew 25, it's really looking at an investment of the skills and the abilities. In this particular case, it was money, but we can quite easily relate that to the things we've been given. Yes, it's financial. Yes, it's our time and it's our talent. So if we look at the three T's of time, talent, and treasure, you know, what are we doing? You know, it's a real challenge with the talents that we have. Are we using them for the kingdom? Are we using them in a way in which God can really be blessed with and point people towards the kingdom, towards his Savior, Jesus Christ? And we look at our time. Are we using our time wisely? If you marry those two things up, our time and our talents, they're two things that actually come together, and we can so easily be focused on using our time to gain finance or to gain treasure. And whilst that's right on one hand, there needs to be things merging, coming together, that we are going to be rewarded with that which we've been given. And so it's not just about us and what we're taking. It's about what we're giving and how we're giving to other people. So It's those three T's I just want us to ponder on really through this week. Are what are we doing with our time, and how are we using it to progress the kingdom? What are we doing with our treasure? There's an opportunity to give always, and not just on a Sunday. We can give of the things and talents that we have. And then our actual talents, how are we using our talents? Actually, how many of us are using our talents in our day-to-day lives? Are we using our talents in the office place, in the workplace? Are we using those things? So I just want to encourage you to think about those things and to really make changes. So if you're not spending enough time, or you're not spending enough of your time on your talent and using your talent, then there's a change that can happen. And I'd encourage you to look for ways during the week, not just on a Sunday, to offer and to be kind and generous to other people. So hopefully that will be something that you can take through the week, and you can have conversations with people in your Connect group and through the WhatsApp group that we have online. And it's a great thing for us to be able to develop and for us to be able to talk about. So have a great week as you think about these things, and let's all be people that want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant.
What a great encouragement from Andy Booth there. I really love hearing what he has to say and his passion for Christ. And so now we're just going to have a quick message from Pastor Steve, who's going to talk to you about an interview that he has coming up.
Hi, Life City, good to be with you again. I just want to give you advance notice that on Wednesday, the 19th of August, we will be screening our second interview from our Let's Talk About Racism series. This interview again is with Pastor Marcia from Gateway Church, and we really want to encourage you to tune in there and just to really just think about some of the things that we're talking about. At the end of that interview, around about 8 p.m., we'll be opening an online lounge for you to be able to come in should you wish, and just take time with others to really discuss the content and your thoughts and feelings all surrounding racism in our society. But to tell you a little bit more about the video, here's Pastor Marcia.
Thanks, Steve. Yeah, the first interview was really important, and it came out of the tragic death of George Floyd. And this second interview allows us to really dig deeper and look at the notions, the reasons why topics such as racism evoke a sense of defensiveness and a discomfort. So I'm really hoping that as we look at this topic, we start to look at the issues that really matter.
So, Life City, really want to just remind you, 7:30, the 19th of August, tune into our YouTube channel to watch the second interview on Let's Talk About Racism, and 8 p.m., come and join us in our online lounge. I think it's going to be a great time. See you there.
So, for my offering today, I'm going to be reading from Timothy 6, 17 to 19. It says, "Teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money, which is so unreliable. Their trust should be in God, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. Tell them to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works and generous to those in need, always being ready to share with others. By doing this, they'll be storing up their treasure as a good foundation for the future of that, so that they may experience true life." And this kind of got me thinking, when we focus on money and we worry about money, what are we missing out from? What is this true rich life that we're missing out on? And I don't want to be a person who spends my time worrying about money, which is unreliable and I can't trust in, when I've got God who I can trust in every way. And I think when we're generous, we experience that true life because we're doing relationship with other people. And that is what Christianity is all about. Relationship with God and relationship with people. So I'd just like to pray over that today. Lord Jesus, we just thank you that we are of generous spirit. We thank you that you have given us opportunity for relationship, and I pray that we don't miss those opportunities. I pray blessing over this offering. Amen.
Hello, Life City. Love you all and can't wait to see you again. I know that lots of you are wondering when that will be, so I'm here on behalf of the senior leadership team to give you an update. The SLT have been checking and keeping up to date with the latest government guidelines and developments, communicating with other churches and leaders, and having fortnightly virtual leadership meetings. Alongside our digital church, which we will continue to develop and enhance, we're planning a three-stage return to physical church activities. We're going to ask for your help and support in this as we plan through a short survey. The first stage will be to restart our physical connect groups, Catalyst, Deeper, Embers, Stronger, Young Adults, and Films and Food. We hope to be able to do this from mid to late August, and only once all the necessary plans, adaptations, and health and safety steps are in place. And only once the group leaders are confident and ready to resume, and you are happy and ready to attend. The second stage will be an adapted Sunday service at Woodcote High School. At the moment, we're working with the school to confirm the date, but we're hopeful that this will be at the start of September. There will obviously be the need for careful planning and changes to the way we run our normal Sunday service. And much more will be communicated about this over the coming weeks. The third stage will be youth and Wiser, PALS, Footy, and all the other groups as soon as the guidance permits and we are ready and able to resume. There will be a very short survey coming your way through our app and social media platforms over the next week. Your responses will help us shape how and when we return to these physical church activities. So please make sure you complete the survey. I hope this update gets you excited about how we will soon be able to physically come back together as Life City. In the meantime, continue to enjoy our digital church activities, stay safe and well, and stay connected. God bless.
Good morning, Life City, and a pleasant good morning for everyone who's joining us again for a time of prayer, worship, and also the Word. So, we were praying yesterday with uptake, and some of these points have been taken from our prayer time. My first point is to pray for those who, you know, have experienced loss during this pandemic. Perhaps have lost a loved one, and also have gone through maybe disappointment during this time. You maybe have, you know, been praying for something and you haven't seen the actual result of that. The promises that you believe that God has promised you have not come to fruition as yet. And because of that, and as a result of that, you become unsettled. Perhaps a lot of you have drifted from the faith. And we've been, you know, not feeling that peace and joy that you want to have. So I want us to pray today that you will experience a renewed strength and that you will be reminded of God's plans and purpose for your lives. And my Bible verse is taken from Isaiah 26 verses 3 that says, "You will keep in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. And similar, you know, theme and concept from Jeremiah 29 verse 11, for I know the thoughts I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and hope. Shall we pray? Father, I thank you this morning that, Father, Lord God, you are the God of hope. You are the God of peace. And Father, we know that even in this pandemic, that people have lost your love and they have experienced loss and disappointment. We understand that. But Father, I pray that right now, that Father, they will receive a renewed strength, Father. I pray that, God, your peace will be upon them right now. I pray that you will breathe afresh on them this morning, Father. And I pray that you will remind them, Father, of your love towards them. Father, you will remind them that you, your thoughts towards them is not of evil, but you want to give them hope, future, and an expected end. And Father, I know at times, Father, our faith is based on the fact that we have experienced your hands and your goodness. But Father, I pray in this time and in this season that, Father, they will experience your heart. They will know your heart towards them, Father, and how much you love them. And I pray for a peace, Father God, that passes all understanding, that they will commit every plan, every ideas, every desire that they have to you in this season. And I pray that you will give them rest on every side. Father, give them peace, Father, and allow them to rest in your perfect, unconditional, reckless love towards them. So I pray right now, Father, for that fresh wind of peace and hope and joy to be upon them, Father, that they will experience you right now in this season like never before, Father, and that they will trust your hands and you will keep them in perfect peace. In Jesus' name, amen. And my next prayer point is, at the moment, the government has lifted a lot of restrictions, and I can see that a lot of churches are now beginning to reopen. So I want us to pray that God will breathe a fresh wind over the churches and give church leaders and also members strategies, ideas, and wisdom to put in place structures and perhaps activities, you know, that will impact our communities like never before. And also give leaders visions of what that new normal will look like, and also fill their hearts with, you know, more passion and compassion, that will lead, you know, that we can be able to lead in accordance to your divine will and power. And also help us that as we as a church begin to yield to the prompting of God, that you will pour out your spirit upon us, as Joel talks about, and that we'll begin to, you know, to share even more and more the good news of Jesus Christ, so that lives can be saved, can be healed, and can be transformed. And also pray that there will be a residue of the presence of God in our churches at the moment like never before, that it will bring healing and transformation to everyone that experienced that. And my Bible verse is from Proverbs 29 verses 18, that says, where there is no revelation, people cast off restraint, but blessed is the one who heeds wisdom and instruction. And the same is also in James 1 verse 5, that said, if we lack wisdom, we could ask of it. Shall we pray? Father, I thank you right now, Father, for what you're about to do in our churches. And Father, as we're about to reopen, Father, I pray that you will give church leaders around the world, Father, wisdom and knowledge, Father, of your will, of what it is that you intend for us to do, Father, as we move forward. Father, I know we have actually, you know, have been doing online experience and online churches, but Father, as we go back to meeting together, I pray that you will give our leaders, Father, continued wisdom and knowledge in how we can lead and reach and impact our communities for you, Father, of how, Father, we can be given that evangelism spirit, Father, that we can go and evangelize and reach the world for your kingdom and for your glory. Father, I pray that you will breathe a fresh anointing over your people. I pray that, Father, we will pour out your presence and your spirit, Father, in this time, in your churches. Help us, Father, that there will be a revival in our midst, Father. And I pray that, God Almighty, that in this season, Father, as we come back together, that your presence will be so evident, will be so strong in our midst. I even pray that even during our worship session, Father, that people that comes in that feeling low, that feeling heavy-hearted, that feeling depressed and feeling low, that there will be breakthrough that will take place in our midst, that healing will take place, that transformation will take place. And Father, I pray that us as leaders, Father, Lord God, we will say as Moses, we will not go unless your spirit go with us. Father, give us that mindset. Give us, Father God, that, Father God, hope in you that we will not do anything unless your presence go with us. And Father, I pray for that freshness. I pray that you will renew our strength. You will give us wisdom and knowledge of how to move forward, Father God, in you. And I pray that, God, life will be transformed. I pray that people will come to us and say, show us your ways. Show us what you are doing that is so different, Father. And I pray that we will see a manifestation of your power and of your presence in this season like never before. Father, move with us, Father. Let your presence and your cloud fill the atmosphere and fill our churches, Father, so we can see miracles taking place like never before. In Jesus' name, Father, we thank you for what is to come, and we bless you and glorify you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, Life City. So good to be with you again. Hope you've had a fantastic week. Sun's been shining. You've probably been out barbecuing and doing all of that kind of stuff. Hey, I've got the second part of a message series I began last week called Stay Positive. And I don't know about you, but I just think in these days, having a sense of optimism in our life is so important. We kind of looked at that last week, didn't we? The whole idea of having an optimistic outlook, you know, where you believe that there is positive change ahead, as opposed to having that pessimistic outlook on life where, you know, you think everything's going poorly, yeah, that the events that happen that can be negative are personal, yeah, and permanent. And we've got to come to combat that with two key things we looked at last week. We looked at the whole idea of releasing, yeah, the joy that we have in God. It says just, yeah, in your presence there is fullness of joy. You know, when we're in the presence of God, we can just see that joy, yeah, bubbling up and out of our lives. And, you know, sometimes people think joy is about being super excited. It's not so much. That's rejoicing, my friends. That's about, you know, jumping up and down, spinning around, knowing how good God is. Having biblical joy is a peaceful contentment, knowing that God is able and he's working ahead of you and me to bring change. And we need to release that joy. James says, count it all joy, brethren, when you fall into various trials. Maybe you've had a trial this week. Maybe you're in the midst of a trial. Maybe you're out the other side of one and have got a testimony of the goodness of God. But we need to have that joy being released in our lives. And the second thing that we need to look at, and we talked about last week, was the whole idea of raising our expectation. We don't need low expectations, yeah, of God. We need high expectations. I love that verse that says that he can do more than we can ever imagine or dream or think. We love quoting it, but we know we've got to begin to try and live it a little bit. And so staying positive, yeah, requires intention. You've got to be intentional, yeah, about your positivity. It's easy at times when you feel, yeah, that life's not going the way you want it to go. It's easy at times to think, you know, I'll let all that negativity come out of my mouth. But no, we've got to be intentional. And that starts with being positive about yourself. Yeah, see, it doesn't take much to trigger our insecurities. I don't know about you, it doesn't take much actually to trigger my insecurities. Sometimes it can be a wrong look or a wrong word, or we got some poor feedback on a work project, or our health is suffering, or there's a lack of finances. You know, when we look in our bank account, there's not as much as we'd like to be there, or perhaps we've got relational problems. It's easy, yeah, for, yeah, our insecurities to be triggered. And, you know, that's combated even more by the fact that our self-talk, yeah, that internal voice, you know, is constantly either moving us forward or pulling us back. It's either speaking, yeah, positively, or it's speaking negatively, depending on what, yeah, are the current thoughts that we have floating around in our mind. And so, you know, we have got to take hold of those pessimistic doubts, Yeah, because they easily chip away at our confidence. You know, those doubts that come in that says that God's not able, that breakthrough is not coming, that that prayer I pray, it's not going to happen. You know, we've got to turn that on its head sometimes and say, I can have confidence that when I pray, God hears me. And he will grant the petitions that, you know, I ask of him. We've got to have that optimistic view that says that, you know, God is, yeah, my guide. He is my source. He is my supply. And so I think that's so important. And it begs this question then. We've got to come to this place where it begs this question. Where does our confidence come from? Who is it in? I was looking on Amazon, as you do when you're looking for a book. And I just put in, you know, confidence, and it came up with hundreds of books. These were some of the titles that came up. Learning to Love Yourself, always a good one. Pressure Makes Diamonds, interesting title. Don't Let Anyone Make You Small, a bit difficult for me since I'm 6'7". Own Your Own Life, and my favorite was Unstoppable Self-Confidence. And all of those books, I suppose in some measure give you, yeah, a truth. They give you an ability to be able to consider and move forward. And I don't know about you, I like psychology. You know, I like reading about it. It's interesting to study it. But psychology, yeah, the study of the human mind and human behavior can never replace theology. Or if I can put it like this, can never replace Godology. Yeah, Paul, the apostle, said this in 1 Corinthians 10, and I'm reading from the message here. He said, forget about self-confidence. It's useless. It's pretty Paulish, isn't it? You know, he kind of says those things. Self-confidence, kind of a waste of time. Cultivate God-confidence. Proverbs 3:26 says this, for the Lord will be your confidence. Psalm 34:19 says, some boast in chariots, some in horses, but we will boast in the name of God. Of the Lord. Hey, I want to boast in the name of God about what he's done, yeah, what he is doing and what he can do. Yeah, and we need to keep that optimistic outlook. We need to starve our fears and feed our faith, knowing that God, yeah, is more than able. I just want to speak that out because I think some of you need to hear that. God is more than able right now in your circumstances and in your situations to bring breakthrough and to take you to a new place and a new level. See, confidence only in self has limitations. Confidence in God has no limit. You see, when we talk about self-confidence, what we're talking about is our trust, yeah, in our own abilities, our trust in our own strength, our own gifts and qualities. I suppose if you want to say it's a belief in oneself. But God confidence, yeah, God confidence is this, that we are more with God, yeah, than without him. That my abilities go further when God is involved. My strength may fail, but his strength never will. My faith is grounded in Christ, not in myself. My confidence in me is based on Christ in me. He is the hope of glory. He that is in me is certainly greater than myself and certainly greater than the enemy that's in this world. Romans 8:31, you know, says this. It says, if God is for us, who can be against us? You know, we love that. If God is for me, who can be against me? Well, do you believe that? Do you have confidence? Yeah, that if God is for you, and I believe he is, if you are a Christ follower today, if you come into that place of relationship with Jesus Christ, yeah, God is your protector. He is your supply. If God is for us, who can ever be against us? If your focus is on your own self, yeah, then we're going to have to deal with the issues of life by ourselves. But if our focus is on him, he is more than faithful and able to walk alongside you and me. You see, one of the things we've got to consider about, yeah, self-confidence and having confidence in ourselves is that my attitudes are changeable. My behaviors, yeah, are variable, and my words, yeah, are inconsistent. Think about that for the moment. My attitudes are changeable. I can feel like this one day and feel like that another day. My behaviors are variable. Yeah, how I behave in one situation is not always how I behave in another. And my words can be up one day and maybe down the next. There's an illustration that I want to just sort of speak from the Gospels to you for a few moments about the disciples. You know, Jesus sent them out at one point. He sends them out to minister, to preach the gospel, to do the works that they'd been watching him do. And they go out and they have a phenomenal time. In fact, when they come back, they're super excited about what God has done through them. So much that, you know, Jesus wants to hear about it. And he takes them off to a place where they can just have some downtime from all the ministry that they've been doing. But, you know, here's the thing. When people see an answer, yeah, before them, they want to chase after that. And so the people followed after Jesus. And whilst the disciples were kind of wanting some downtime and talking about all the things they'd been doing, Jesus saw the people and he goes out to minister them. And it's interesting because we know that as the story of the feeding of the 5,000, but the disciples weren't too hip with that. They weren't too pleased about that. They kind of wanted, yeah, Jesus to be with them, to do their thing. Yeah, they were really confident about what God had done. And yet Jesus wanted to move into a new arena, into a new level. And you would have thought that they would have been, you know, right on the ball, so confident to come out and do that with him, but they didn't. And so Jesus performs this miracle. Anyhow, the upshot is that they all go. Jesus goes off to pray and he sends the disciples across the lake. And a storm comes up. A storm, yeah, just appears. You ever felt like that sometimes? That one minute you seem to be up and the next minute a storm's hitting you? But the point that I'm trying to make here is that they had all this self-confidence. Yeah, because what God had done through them in the ministry and in the teaching, in the praying for people, in the casting out of demons, in the healing of people. And now they're on a boat and there's no self-confidence anymore. What there is now, doubt. Fears are rising. And it's so interesting that they feel they're going to die. And Jesus, what's he doing? He's walking on the water. Jesus is walking on the water. And even when they think they see him, they think it's a ghost because they've lost all confidence. That ability to look with faith has disappeared, and now they're just looking with their feelings. And I want to say to you, we've got to come to a place where our confidence is rooted in God. You see, God's attitudes don't waver. His behavior is consistent and his word is unchanging. Yep. My attitude may change from day to day. My behavior may be a little inconsistent. Yeah, my words, yeah, may be a bit variable, but with God, he does not waver. He is consistent. He is unchanging. And the psalmist wrote this in Psalm 57. It says, "My heart is confident in you, O God. My heart is confident. No wonder I can sing your praises." You see, when you've got a confidence in God, you can sing his praises. When you've got a confidence in God, yeah, you know that no weapon formed is going to prosper against you. You can have confidence that God completes what he says, yeah, he is going to do. Whatever God begins, he finishes. Philippians 1:6 says this, "I am confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion." And I want to say, God has begun works in, yeah, your life and in my life, and he is faithful, yeah, to carry it to completion, to see it to its end, to see it to its yet fulfillment. And we've got to have confidence that whatever God has begun, he will start. Some of you right in the middle of some storms, some of you right in the middle of some trials, don't let the pessimistic outlook in life take hold of you. Don't let that negativity grasp you. We've got to come to a place where we are constructing confidence in our life. We are building that confidence in our God into our life. You see, confidence can't be seen because it starts unseen. Think about that for the moment. Yeah, confidence, yeah, can't always be seen because it starts internally. There's got to be that fruition, that sowing of seeds, you know, that roots that go down internally in your life about your confidence in God that will eventually be seen, yeah, coming and flowing out of your life. Because confidence is a fruit that comes from God, yeah, as you trust and have faith in him. Hey, I want to give you three keys about constructing confidence in your life. The first one is you've got to listen to the right voice. You've got to listen to the right voice. There's four voices that are going on all of the time around you. There's the voice of the world. That's everything that's happening, everything you can hear, the news you watch, you know, the voice of the world, it's there. Then there's your voice, your self-talk, that inner voice that talks to you all the time. It's giving you a running commentary, yeah, all the time, and everything that's happening. Even now as I'm preaching, your self-talk is either in agreement or not. It's either questioning or not. And then there's the voice of the enemy. The enemy is always trying to speak into your life and into my life to try and bring us lower than God would have us, to try and bring us down instead of lifting us up. And then there's the voice of the Holy Spirit. But here's the thing, with so much noise going on, so many voices vying for our attention, we've got to learn to tune in. You see, sometimes we've got to place ourselves in the right position. Jesus went to pray often alone. He would minister, he would be with people, and then it said that he would go off into the hills and the mountains to pray. Why? So he could reduce the background noise, so he could reduce the clutter of voices around him. You see, you and I, we've got to make space for God's voice to come through clearly. You see, when Elijah was stuck in that cave, a fire comes, and he thought, God's bound to be in the fire, but God's voice was not there. Then an earthquake comes, you think, God's got to be in the earthquake, and God's voice was not there. That's where he expected it, in the fire and in the earthquake. But God's voice came as a still, small voice that he had to tune in onto and also kind of lean his ear towards to hear. You see, our confidence grows when we hear with clarity God's voice. And I want to really challenge you today. You have got to come to a place where you are allowing God's voice to come to you clearly. The second thing I want to talk about is you've got to use the right words. Which words carry the most power and authority in your life? Which words carry the most power and authority in your life? What are you listening to? Because words have been spoken. What are you reading? Because words have been spoken. What's carrying the most power and authority in your life? You see, when Jesus went out into the desert to be tempted, the enemy spoke words to him. He said, look, hey, if you're hungry, see these stones, turn them into bread. I have no doubts that Jesus could have done that, absolutely. And it's interesting that Jesus responds with God's word, not his word, but God's word. It said, it is written. It is written, And we've got to come to a place where it's not our words that we're using, but it's God's words that we're using. He spoke revelation, he spoke authority, and he spoke power, that flowed from God's word. And when you do that, my friend, the enemy has no comeback for your life. I love playing Scrabble, and it was interesting. I was playing a game just the other night, and I played a particular word, and the person I was playing with asked me what the word meant. And I kind of said, this is what it means. It was a word called ego surf. And I played it for seven letters, got lots of points of it. He said, what does that mean? And I said, that's where people Google themselves on the internet to see if they can find their name or find a picture of themselves. It's all about, surfing to feed their ego. But here's the thing. This is what I learned. This is what the Holy Spirit said to me. He said, you can't confess what you don't know. You can't use words that you don't understand. And I think so often the reason we feel weak in our Christian life when it comes to the words that carry so much power and authority when it comes from the Word of God is because we don't know what they mean. We don't know what the Word of God has to say to us. But yet Psalm 119 says this, your word is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. Romans 15:4 says this, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. Hey, we've got to come to that place where we are listening to the right voice and we're using the right words. This third thing I want to talk about is we've got to respond in the right way. We've got to respond in the right way. Jesus' life was an example in response to the leading of God by the Holy Spirit. I love where Jesus says, I do nothing that I haven't seen my Father do. I say nothing that I haven't heard my Father say. The reason he was led out into the wilderness is because that's where the Holy Spirit took him. And there's this thing about, what's leading a life and how do we respond? And we've got to learn to respond in the right way. When God is leading, we can have confidence that he is taking us in the right direction. So if I could put it like this, we've got to be submitted to his leading. That means we've got to put our mission under the mission of God. We've got to put our position under the position of God. We've got to be submitted to his leading, and we've got to be committed to his ways. 2 Corinthians 2 says this. It says, in Christ, God leads us from place to place in one perpetual victory parade. I don't know about you, but I love that. The fact that God leads us. When we're submitted, he leads us in triumph. When we're committed, we know that we are in the best place that we can be, doing the best things that we can do. And I don't know about you, but I want you to construct your confidence in God today. Hey, wherever you are right now, why don't you jump to your feet? Because I'm going to pray. And I'm going to believe as I pray today, the Holy Spirit is going to touch your heart and touch your life. I really believe for a fresh inflow into your life where confidence will be birthed like a new spring in your heart. So come on, let's pray right now. Father, I thank you that you are our source. You are our supply, Lord. Father, that our confidence can be in you, that no weapon formed against our lives, Lord, is going to prosper when we are with you. Father, I thank you that you work all things for our good. Father, we can have a confidence, Lord, that even in the trials, even in the difficulties, even in the storms, you are with us, Lord. We can feed our faith to rely on you, to have a confidence that when we pray, you hear us, God. And Father, right now I pray for that just new flow into people's hearts and lives, that they would lead confident lives, Lord, that they would have a confidence in their words, Lord. Father, that we would listen to your voice, Lord, that we would use the right words, and Lord, that we would have the right response. And Father, I pray that today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, you may have tuned in today, and it might be your first or maybe your second time. And maybe something I've said today has really just touched you, and you know that you need to get your life right with God. And you can do that right now in a moment. I'm going to pray a prayer, and you can pray it right after me. And you can receive Jesus into your heart and life. And I want you to know your life's never going to be the same. You can have a confidence that when you pray this prayer, your life is going to come into a new place. It's going to be a new experience for you, because when Jesus touches your heart and life, you're never the same again. So come on, why don't you pray that prayer after me? Lord Jesus, I thank you that you love me. Thank you that you gave your life for me. Today, I turn from my sin and I reach out to you. I thank you that you love me. You are my Lord and my Savior. And from this day, I will live my life for you. Amen. Hey, if you prayed that prayer today, we would really encourage you. Right now in the chat window there, you'll see a little thing that says, I raise my hand. Hey, if you prayed that prayer today, just click on there so we know and we can celebrate that you prayed a prayer that's forever going to change your life, and you can have a confidence in God that he is your God, he is your Savior. He'll never leave you, never forsake you. Hey, I really want to encourage your life this week. Have a great week. Really, maybe contact somebody, give them a WhatsApp or a text, or give them a call. It'd be great to do life together. Have a great week.
Hey, that was a great preach from Pastor Steve. Fantastic. We are going to finish with a song this morning. And yeah.
The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You'll not fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I
What an encouraging message from Pastor Steve there. When we stop focusing on ourselves and put our confidence in God, we enter this new realm into His possibility and His positivity. So don't forget, the Connect Lounge is going to be open at the end of today's service. Just click on the link up here and we would love to speak to you at the end of today. If not, we'll see you next Sunday at 10:15 for the in-service chat. Have a great week.